Yeah, so I'm Adam, I'm from the University of Malta, and today the idea is to introduce you to some data sources, some online data sources that you can access free of charge and you can download some ocean data from. I think this lesson links quite well with the previous one where you discussed Copernicus, right? So it's more hands-on today, all right? So I'll show you like the links you can use, how you can download data, and what you can do with that. Now, unfortunately, I'm not really a fan of the online thing because I can't really interact with you guys, but please feel free to unmute yourself. They have that power, no? Yes, they can unmute yourself and like say hello or like ask questions whenever you feel like, okay? Yes, I planned the session to be about 1 hour, 1 hour, 15 minutes. I know it's Friday. I know it's Friday afternoon. So most of you don't really like to be sitting in front of a computer. So yes, but we'll try to make this as interesting as possible. Yeah, so let's start. So if I can share my screen, where is the PowerPoint? There you go. But if I do that, probably they won't see it. Let me share the entire screen. All right. You can see it? Yes. All right. So, and you know about this course, it's the marine data literacy course. Do you need to record it or something, or it's automatic? It's recorded automatically. All right. So this is the marine data literacy course, and we're going to talk about data harvesting and data harnessing, all right, and specifically the available online data portals that you can access. Now, I normally I like to start with these two quotes. Like, first of all, data is acquired and prepared once to be used by many. All right, that is the whole ideology. So data is acquired and prepared once, not everyone prepares the same data, and then it's used by a lot of people. All right, and the more people that use it, the more value your data will have. The other one is you can't manage what you can't measure, and that give like highlights the importance of measuring parameters, especially when it comes to the ocean, okay? So it's a massive resource. In our case, Malta, which is the smallest island, I think, in the CEU alliance, we have much more ocean territory than terrestrial, right? In fact, we have like 14 times more water territory than land. So it's a massive resource that we must measure and take out as much as possible from our the surrounding seas. But anyway, so before we do that, I have some questions for you. So if I had to ask you, this level trend in the last 30 years, do you think it's increased, decreased, or remained the same? Is that is a question you answer in silence at home, because no one will unmute himself. But basically, if we had to... Yes, we have the chat. Yes, so you'll take care of the chat. All right, so we have a lot of increased replies, which is good. If we look at the data, in the last 30 years, we had a quite a steep incline in the sea level, right? Sea level rise. Second question about the sea temperature. Do you think in the last 30 years, the sea temperature increased, decreased, or remained the same? Now I look at the oracle, and the oracle says, nothing so far? Increased as well. All right, we get some replies with increase. And you're right. If we look at the data, all right, we see that there was an increase. Last question, promise, guys, the waves. Where do you think we have the highest waves in the Mediterranean? In the west coast, west area, in the central part, or in the eastern part? And if we don't get any answers, actually, that's what I'm trying to prove, that without data, you can't really answer these questions, right? But do you have some replies? No, which is good. But if we look at the data, we look at the graphs, we see that most of the, can you see my mouse moving? Yes. Most of the high level, high waves, most of the strongest waves, the highest waves were here, all right, in the Western Basin. So, again, but the importance is data, right? We need a lot of data to be able to, first of all, see what's happening and check whether these extreme events that we're having right now are actually part of some cycle, whether they're extreme, whether we experienced them before. All right, and also to have a tool for stakeholders so that they can take informed decisions and make good policies. And this is the outline of today. So I'm going to show you a little bit about Copernicus. You heard about what the Copernicus is and from where it originated. So we'll talk about the data portal that you can access, how you can download NetCDF files, the Panoply, that it's a software to visualize NetCDF files, and MATLAB scripts. I'm going to show you sort of what we can do with, but not really go into the MATLAB code itself. Then we talk a little bit about the European Space Agency Data Hub, from where you can download actual satellite products, all right, which are available in near real time. So even today, we can access data that was captured yesterday. And we'll talk a little bit about SNAP. We saw how this can be used for oil spill detection. And here I'm only giving you a teaser, because then when you're back, when you're in split together, I think you'll actually have a tutorial on how you can actually detect oil spill from space. And then we mentioned a little bit about MODnet, all right, and about the various portals that are available there. If we have time, we'll mention the World Ocean Database, or at least I'll tell you from where you can access some data sets that are related to CTDs or some other equipment that's being deployed. All right, so data. When it comes to data in the sea, at least, all right, there are three ways of how we can collect the data. First of all, you have the in situ method. The in situ is you take your instrument, you go in a particular location at a particular time, and you deploy your instrument and you get some measurement, right? Which is good, is the most accurate way, at least in my opinion. However, there are some limitations. First of all, if it's winter and if it's strong weather, rough weather, it might be a little bit not too comfortable to go. And Audrey and I had our share of strong weather. Okay, but it's very expensive as well. I mean, you have to rent a boat, especially if you don't own one, by your own research institute, and you have to have a skipper, you have to plan a lot, etc. So in situ is good, but it has its limitations. So we move on to remote sensing. And with remote sensing, we will put the instrument on a kite, on a plane, on a hot air balloon, on a satellite. And the nice thing is that we see a much larger area, all right? At the same time, we have a look at a much larger area, so we get more information. And then there's the periodicity. For instance, if the instrument is on a satellite, you know that this satellite will have a revisit time, for instance, of 2 days. So in 2 days, you're going to get exactly the same parameter. However, the main difficulty with remote sensing is that you have the atmosphere and clouds in between. So sometimes clouds, although they're nice to look at, they're puffy and they look smooth. When it comes to remote sensing, they limit the data we can collect, because they can absorb some of the most interesting wavelengths we look at. All right, so there are limitations as well. And for instance, if you have like an eruption of a volcano, so you have a lot of aerosols in the air, then that will create a bias in your measurements, in your sea surface temperature or salinity or what you're trying to measure. But it's good, because it's there every day, and it has the periodicity. And then there's the third type that I'm absolutely not an expert in, is the models, all right? So these are numerical models, numerical code, that are capable of also forecasting how the state of the sea will be in the next 3-4 days. And the nice thing about this is that they are all related, all right? So you have models that are able to forecast, and they are important, because you want to know where the jellyfish will go, or which areas are hotter to swim, or the amount of waves that you'll have if you like to, for instance, go out with the boat. So you have models to forecast. But models, although they're just numerical, you can assimilate data in them so that they're made more accurate, all right? And normally you use data from remote sensing techniques, so that the models are made more accurate. And on the other hand, remote sensing techniques rely on in situ data, so that we calibrate them and make also remote sensing techniques more accurate. Okay, so you compare what the satellite gives you with what you actually measure on planet Earth, so that you make sure that your data sets are as accurate as possible. So this is the whole story of how we can get data when it comes to the wet part of our planet, all right, the oceans. Again, if you need anything, and either you have some buttons in front of you, those are called keys, all right? They're on a keyboard. If you want, you can use them and send a very nice message to Audrey here, and she'll read it out loud, so that we make this as interactive as possible. All right, so that's the first part. So how am I going to get this data in situ from remote sensing and from models, especially if you're doing your studies, you're doing your master's, your PhD, and you want such information for your project, all right? So there's this very, very, very important service, all right? I would say the most important two are Copernicus and MODnet, and that's why I'm going to mention them. So Copernicus is a free service. It started as individual projects, all right? But now the European Commission actually gives money to this on a yearly basis. Copernicus, sometimes it's called CMEMS, the Copernicus Marine Environmental Monitoring Service, CMEMS. Right? And this is a free service that gives us information and real-time products about some in-situ measurements, but mostly it's related to satellite as well as model data, all right? And when I say satellites, we don't mean the raw data sets that we get from Sentinel, and we're going to mention what this is, but products related to the ocean. So when we say products, we mean temperature, salinity, currents, all right? And I know that last time you discussed level 3 and level 4, so now you know all about that. All right, so Copernicus, if you go to the website, it looks like this, all right? Instead of seeing slides, I think we can have a look at the website directly. Wait, because I have the Zoom thing in the center. All right, it is this one. And Copernicus gives us four main ways of how you can access the data. All right. First of all, let's start with the state report. So every year, the Copernicus service issues this ocean state report. They are currently at the version 7. All right. And they basically analyze the trends and they give a summary of the state of our ocean. So it's very important, especially if you want to quote some official source about whether the sea is rising, the temperature is rising. And guess what? We go to the first questions that we ask you, like from the ocean state report. All right, so that's a very good summary that is produced every year. And then there's the ocean monitoring indicators, which this is also a good service, but they take specific parameters and they give you the trends, all right, of how they are progressing, increasing, decreasing, etc. So while the ocean state report is more of a formal report, a publication, the indicators are just graphs. All right, and you can select whether you're interested in circulation, the climate, the ocean health, etc. All right, you indicate, and then you get the charts that you're interested in, and very nice infographics. Then we move on to the last. I will describe the first one, don't worry, I will not forget the last one, all right, which is ocean visualization. And here they give us three different levels of how we can visualize all this data, all right? The first one, which is for kiddies, it's for the beginners, probably not for you, is basically a globe of the ocean, all right? You can rotate it and you can select whether you're interested in salinity, temperature, currents, etc. And it gives you an overview, like a climatology of how these change, all right? Very nice graphics as well. But if you want to demonstrate something, like here, because the Ionian stream or the main conveyor belts we have in the Med, and we can actually visualize these very, very good, all right, in a nice way. Obviously, you can't like really download data or in that in the mid, all right, which is the intermediate one, which also for you. It's probably not as advanced as you would like. But yeah, it's really nice, especially I know you guys sometimes are asked questions like by your friends or by the media or by other peers, right? Like to get quick information. And this, I even we use it a lot for that, all right? So it's again another simple interface. You select the parameter you want. I don't know, let's go to chlorophyll, all right? And when you click on a point, a pixel, you get the time series. Okay, so you get time series over the last few years, you get a time series with depth, a depth profile, and you can also vary this through the timeline you have down here. All right, so you can see where the peaks are, etc. And this is good to extract trends. Like if you want to see the trends of a particular area, you can zoom in. Sorry, I'm a bit too patriotic and I always get examples around Malta, right? But you can see here that we already start to see these boxes, all right, this resolution. So these models are not, they are good, they're very good models, but the resolution is not great, all right? So we're talking about 4 kilometer resolution. It depends on the parameter you're visualizing, right? So with temperature, for instance, it's a better resolution. I have to zoom in to see these boxes, all right? And for chlorophyll, it's a lower resolution. The product comes at a lower resolution. So you have to keep all these in mind, all these things in mind, right? And obviously, the statistics from every box will be the same because the data in this box is the same. But you can click on different boxes and get statistics and this time series for different areas. All right. You can also register and download the data now, all right, as a CSV. So you can export the data as a comma separated values, and then you import it in the programming. You process it as you want, whether you want to use MATLAB, Excel, QGIS. All right. So you process the data you want. So this is the second one, the middle tier. Then they also give us the last one, which is the pro. All right. And that's where you come in. And this is visualizing in a much more professional way. All right. So you can add the layers. You can find the product that you want, such as, for as I want in the Mediterranean. So I have 48 products in the Mediterranean. And here you see like whether you want waves, you want the biogeochemistry, you want the forecast. And now I know that you they did know the difference between the forecast and the reanalysis, yes. Right? Of how they can use remote sensing and in situ to data assimilate and improve on the model. So that's where you can find all this information. Okay. We also have some level 3 products here where you can see the SWOTs, right? So it's not gridded and you can have gaps. Like here, all right. But you have also some level 4 and level 4 satellite as well as models, all right. When it comes to model data, normally it's all level 4 because it's computer generated. But when it comes to satellites, you can have level 3 and you have gaps, or level 4 where those gaps are filled by some mathematical technique. All right. So here you can see some gaps because it's a level 3 satellite product, right? And here, you can also see the resolution. That's what I mentioned before, right? Those boxes, how large those boxes are, right? For instance, this one is 0.01 by 0.01 of a degree. This one is 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer. And also in these, what I call a catalog, all right? You also have the date when they are available. So this is available from the 1st of January 2008 to the 20th of October 2023, which is today. And it's available on a daily basis, all right? So this information allows you to get the details of the product. But here again, you can visualize. But all this information, all these data products, all right, are also available, if you go back to the main Copernicus website, in the ocean products tab. And I left this for last on purpose, okay? So that first I show you the catalog in a visual way. But if you go on ocean products, you can actually now download the actual NetCDF files. All right, so NetCDF files, if you're working on ocean products, on ocean data, you probably heard about this protocol. Like Word, like if you have Microsoft Word, the files are saved at .doc, D-O-C-X, or like Excel, the files are saved as Excel files, XLSX, or text files are saved at .txt. Normally, oceanography data products are saved in this format called NetCDF. All right, it's a binary format, so you need a special program to open them. And one such program is called Panoply. All right, Panoply. It's like, you know, you have that very interesting and nice quiz at the end. Okay, so sometimes I will highlight certain stocks. Like this Panoply is really important to know. And it's good that you know that it can open these NetCDF files. All right. Issa, I'll show you, all right, from like I show you Panoply and how to open files in it, but you can download it for free, right? So if you go to Google and type Panoply download, you'll be taken to this website. It's produced by NASA, this Panoply, all right? And you can just download it from here, all right? You can download Panoply from here. The nice thing that it's available for Mac, for Windows, for Linux, all right? It only requires Java, and normally it has for a very specific Java version, Java 11, right? But you can also get it to work. Sometimes the new Mac that they have the special chip, not the Intel one, they might give some problems until a new version is released. However, so far, we managed to run this on all the computers, right? This Panoply. So how you get these NetCDF files from Copernicus? Basically, first of all, you need to register. Registration is free. There is only a couple of fields you have to fill in, not even your birthday. So they don't even send you a happy birthday on the day. So just your name, your surname, your affiliation, and your email address. All right, once you do that, you can log in, you go to Ocean Products, and again, you have that catalog, all right? So in my case, I'm gonna go to Mediterranean Sea. Let's say I want to download data products that have temperature in them. And here, like it sort of filters all the products for temperature in the Mediterranean Sea. You can also filter whether by the temporary resolution, whether you want daily or monthly or yearly, or whatever you want. All right, or whether you want data only from numerical models or from C2 or from satellites. So you have all these options. Normally, I don't refine my search a lot. Okay, so that I see what's available. I refine just by parameter and region, so that I see what is available. Because sometimes, for instance, the best product is not available up to today, all right, because it's reanalyzed, or it's not available with the required resolution. So sometimes you prefer a level 3 product with higher resolution than a level 4 with a lower resolution. So you have to give or take, all right. But let's say you like this, all right. You want the Mediterranean Sea physics analysis and forecast. Or let's go to I don't know, this one, the Mediterranean Sea high resolution, ultra high resolution surface temperature. All right. If you click on view product, you're automatically taken to the map view I showed you before. All right, where you can add the products there to visualize. If you want to download now, you have that this nice little button there with a disk and the arrow. You click on it and you're taken to the download page. All right, so here you have all the versions that are available for you to download. It's a normally people tell me, but how am I going to know which one? All right, in that case, you have this documentation here, all right, that user manual that tells you exactly what these mean, but you'll get used to them, guys, with a little bit of luck. So this I know that it's a level 4 product, it's a sea surface temperature for the Mediterranean, it's a level 4 product, so I assume a gridded one. It's available in here real time, so I can get data from yesterday. All right, it's observations, and these B and D are the resolutions. All right, but you can get that information from the user manual. Every product that it's uploaded on Copernicus needs to go a quality check. All right, and you'll find that like correlations within C2 measurements and the amount of error that you can expect in the quality information document. And this is really good because if you're writing some paper using this document, these data, you'll probably want to comment on the accuracy of the data you're using, right? And the data you'll find here is quite of high quality. So let's say I want this product, all right? And then you click on this one. I suggest you click on the first one because the download is more interactive, all right? If you're into programming, then you can also try to download the Open Dub, where you can download the code, download the products in an operational way through code. All right. So there's something called the Moto client, and you can automatically link this with Copernicus to download the data. For instance, we have a service in Malta that automatically every day downloads some data products, and it extracts more information from them, so it calculates added value services and added value products, and those we compare with other data that we collect. All right, so you can automate the process automatically as well. But anyway, let's say I want this data product, so I click on link, and you're taken to this very nice page where the first thing you have to do here is specify where you're interested in. All right, so for instance, if you can either input the longitude and latitude directly. However, you can also draw on a map. You say, I'm interested in this part. All right. So the coordinates automatically update. And you're going to download data only for that part. All right. And then you specify from where you want to start and finish your time series. It's obviously and here it tells you an idea. This is important, an idea of the file size that you're going to download. Obviously, if you select a longer time series, this file will go up. All right. Sorry, the 8.65 megabytes. And if you're downloading data from a three-dimensional model, then apart from the area and the time, you also need to specify the depth levels that you want. All right. And if you specify a number of depth levels, for instance, that go up to 500 meters or 1000 meters, then the file size might increase quite a lot. All right. With Copernicus, you can only download files that go up to 124 megabytes. All right, so it's about 1 gigabyte. Yes, about 1 gigabyte per file. So if the file size is larger, you have to split your query. Say either select a smaller time series and then download the rest in another file, or select an area. Yes, also keep in mind that different products come in different resolutions. All right, so for instance, this is 0.042 by 0.042. This is 0.01 by 0.01. We already mentioned this. It's why this happens. First of all, because of the sensor you have on board the satellite or on the model you have available. All right, so models and satellites normally have different resolution. Obviously, it's not like a lower resolution is not useful. All right, sometimes you want a lower resolution model so that you build a higher resolution one in a sub area of that model. Okay, so you have nesting. I'm sure someone is going to mention this nesting, all right, this model nesting. But low resolution models or low resolution data sets doesn't mean that they're not important. All right, they have also their use. Like for instance, if you want a global model, a global that gives you an idea of what happens on the global scale, you don't really need a fine resolution model for that, right? Especially if it's a forecast. Because imagine you want to run a very high resolution model across the entire globe, and it takes you 10 days to run, right, to get the output of one day. So you run it today, and in 10 days' time, you get the output of what will happen tomorrow, right? So that's not really useful. So there's a compromise between computation time and the resolution of the model and the kind of details that you want to see, all right? So different resolutions have different uses. I think this is also important to keep in mind that low-resolution models are also useful. Yes, I can still see four next to the chat. That means that we don't have any questions, right? Or it's either we're losing people, or else they're falling asleep, or else they're preparing to go out, or else they're understanding everything. It's also an option. All right. So this is from where you can get data from the Copernicus portal. Once you download this file, all right, so once, let me do it again quickly. So I click on the download button. I scroll down for the, now this one is a model, you see. All right, so it's a model, the Mediterranean. It's a physical model. And this is the salinity, you see. And the salinity is available on a daily basis, on a monthly basis, on an hour basis. All right, let me select the daily basis. So I click link. And here, exactly like before, so I select my area of interest. Sorry, I'm going to the Central Mediterranean again. I select from where. Let me select the last 3 days. Sorry, this is a forecast, so it can go up to the 29th of October. All right. So let me go from today up to 3 days more, which is 22, for instance. All right. And here, as I told you before, you can specify the levels because it's a model, so it can also forecast what's happening underneath the surface. When it comes to satellite, obviously, you only have the surface, right? The very, very, very surface micrometer, the very skin layer. But when it comes to models, you can have like different layers. And then you click on the nice button here, download, and you start downloading the file. So it's very easy. It's very easy. It's like shopping on Amazon. It's even easier to shop for data, which is free of charge. And then you get this NetCDF file. The extension is .nc. Once you get the NetCDF file, all right, I prepared some because obviously when you're doing demonstrations, something goes wrong. So I prepared some files, all right? Like here, I downloaded two, one from satellite and one from the CMCC. CMCC is a very good research center in Bologna. Anyway, and they produce this model. So let's open it. If you double click on it, then this NC file, it will open in Panoply, all right? I don't know if it's Panoply or Panoply. I think it's Panoply, Mom. You say it, and here in this NetCDF file, you have all this information, all right? It's a binary file, so it contains all this information. Theta is the potential temperature, so if you double-click on it, it will give you automatically a graph. You see, that's the data I downloaded. And you can zoom in like this. I'm holding the command, all right, so that I zoom in. But if you download Panoply, you can experiment a bit. And here, since it's a binary file, I have all this information, like the depth levels. You see different depth levels. All right, so the deeper I go, the less sea I have, because now this is coming rocks, all right, the seafloor at 250 meters. This is seafloor. Apart from the depth, all right, let me go back to the surface. Apart from the depth, and you can change them from here, the depth. You have the time. In this case, I downloaded 72 timestamps. Okay, so you can download the timestamps. You can see it. It's an hourly file. Apart from this, with Panoply, you can actually go to array and see the actual numbers. All right, and you can extract these. And you can flip left, right. You can flick bottom to top. And you can also save this as a CSV file and read it in QGIS. But yes, I mean, like I mentioned, that ArcGIS, QGIS, MSAGA, all of these nowadays can read NetCDF files directly. So you can also visualize this file there. All right. So, and in that case, like if you load this in QGIS, these will be as different bands. So you select the band that you want to visualize and you get exactly this. All right. But Panoply is a good way. You can save it. You can also export this as a KML file. And you import it in Google Earth if you want to visualize it in that way. All right. You can also change the from window. You can open the shading, for instance, and you change the color bar of the data sets, etc. All right. But again, this is the raw data that you can visualize in Panoply. All right. So Panoply is good to visualize NetCDF files. All right, so that's about how you can download data from Copernicus. There is a very good video to conclude kind of this section about Copernicus that we can have a quick look at. And this is about what the Copernicus service is all about. All right, let's have a quick look at this. It's just a couple of minutes, so I think it's worth. I'll give you a break of my voice as well.
Our ocean is vital for human well-being. The future of humanity strongly depends on the ocean's health and on our ability to monitor it. Did you know that the Copernicus Marine Service's mission is to monitor the ocean? We provide 4D regular, authoritative, quality-assured information about the ocean, available for free and accessible from anywhere in the world. We distribute data from on-site buoys and satellites and from the latest science models in order to know more about the past, current, and future state of the blue, white, and green ocean. We make ocean data available that can be used to create applications for a wide range of actors in both the public and private sectors. We also support EU policies and international legal commitments related to ocean governance, catering to the needs of society at large. But you know what? We're not just a data provider. We also offer a large range of services for our users. Because our mission is to empower all users, from scientists to policy managers to private companies, who want to drive the blue economy and scientific innovation. We are there to support you anytime, anywhere, thanks to a dedicated help desk team, a chatbot, FAQs, a collaborative forum, and tutorial videos at your service. We organize events, webinars, and online training sessions to share scientific knowledge and promote sustainable ocean initiatives. And we continuously collect feedback from our users. We know one thing for sure, we need you. We need you to make the right decisions for the future. For a blue-green deal, a healthy ocean, a healthy planet, healthy people.
Okay. All right. So that was the video about Copernicus, basically a summary of what we have discussed. But oopsie, the way again. But yes, obviously, I mean, You can feel the promotion of open science, right? So all this open data that is freely accessible and so that people can use and first of all, interpret the data that's there, as well as provide or implement added value services to extract more information. Yes, so these are a couple of slides that I can share with you eventually. Usha Kodri, yes, we can share these slides, basically a summary of what I'm saying. This is also a nice slide showing the difference in resolution, all right? As we saw in the catalog, there was the resolution. Obviously, the higher resolution, the more details you'll have, all right? But again, low resolution data, this can also be useful. It depends on what you're after. Because obviously, the higher the resolution, the more processing you'll need, and the more storage space and the more bandwidth you'll need to download that data. So yes, so different space and resolutions, you must keep in mind that. As you mentioned also before in the previous lecture, there's the idea of data assimilation, all right? So we deploy instruments such as CTDs or we deploy floats and drifters. Here you can see a very charming young man holding a drifter and a float, all right? So we deploy these around Malta. And the idea is that we collect actual in situ data, all right, observations. And after the model gives us the preliminary output, which is the blue line, we say, listen, all right, you got the general trend right. However, I know that at that time and at that location, the parameter value, whether it's temperature or chlorophyll or salinity, it was not exactly the value you gave me, but it was up here, right? So we rerun the model, we reanalyze the models so that the output is much more accurate. And of course, although within situ, we know that we kind of have the true value at a particular location and time, then the model will correct itself and hopefully it will also give us a better value in the other cells, the other boxes for which we did not take any measurement. All right, so that's the whole idea. So this is about data assimilation. Then in some of the satellite levels, the level 3 and level 4 you discussed last time, but level 3 you might have gaps, level 4 are interpolated. There's a whole, people are kind of have mixed feelings about in your research whether you should use level 3 or level 4. Obviously, level 4 appear nice. They're nice charts. You can have climatologies. If you're doing like a trajectory, if you have a Lagrangian model, for instance, and you're trying to predict the drift of a trajectory of an oil spill, then with level 4, you have the complete data set, so your model will not stop. However, you have to keep in mind how the missing data is being filled, right? Whether it's interpolated, whether it's by AI and machine learning, whether it's by algorithms such as DINOF that use the orthogonal functions of the past data sets to learn the modes. So when you're using level 4 data, keep in mind that certain cells are being inserted mathematically, all right? Because they were not observed. All right, so we did this example of Copernicus. And this is like how you can download the data so that when you're alone going through the slides, you will remember about this moment and when we discussed how you can download the data. All right, and Panoply, again, I also gave you the link here, but if you Google download Panoply, you'll download it and you'll find it immediately. That is a really good visualizing tool of these NetCDF files that you can download, all right? MATLAB, unfortunately, we don't have time to go through MATLAB or to give some examples, and even in the BIP, no, I don't think in the actual physical, we won't be able to go through some MATLAB code. I know you're covering fighting, and with us, with Audrey and I, we're going to do some bathymetric measurements from satellites when we meet and split. However, keep in mind that you can implement your custom code, whether it's MATLAB or Python or R, to read the NetCDF files and basically produce plots such as the ones we saw with Panoply, all right? You can have the nice thing about implementing custom codes is that you can take, for instance, a model data set, all right, and take another data set, such as a satellite data set, and regrid it, all right? So you map it from one resolution onto another resolution so that now they are equivalent, the same grid cells exactly, all right? And you can compare the two. So you can compare now one grid cell from the model with what the satellite measured from at that particular location, all right? So you can get the data sets on a common grid, all right? And as you can see, this as well as I did for a file in 2021, the pattern is there, all right? The pattern is there. Normally some models, especially the low resolution ones, won't be able to forecast or capture the mesoscale variability, such as you have here, all right? So changes over smaller scales. However, the general trend is there. But you can actually immediately see where the model went wrong, kind of, right? Like here, and the satellite measured like higher concentrations higher values of sea surface temperature there. All right, so immediately you can actually see where the model kind of is failing and whether it will improve with time. You can analyze such data sets. So that's why custom code is important. All right, so again, focusing on satellites. With satellites, we can have very good information, very good data. There are, mainly for Earth observation, there are two types of satellites or two missions, the Sentinels by the European Space Agency and the Landsat by NASA, all right? So Landsat, the nice thing about Landsat is they started way back in 1972, Landsat 1, and they launched up to Landsat 9. All right, so Landsat 8 and 9 are the latest, and they give us very good data sets. Unfortunately, you won't find the information from Landsat 6 because that crashed in the Indian Ocean right after launch, so nothing from Landsat 6. However, we get some very good information. So basically, when we have satellites, you have this satellite going around our planet. When we say Earth observing satellites, we're talking about satellites that are between 700 and 900 kilometers above the Earth's surface, right? So that gives them a period, an orbit of about 90 minutes. So in 90 minutes, roughly in the, like in this lesson and a bit, each of these satellites will go around the Earth once, all right? So with a period of 90 minutes, they go around our planet in about 2 days. So in about 2 days, they cover the entire planet, as you can see here. And after they go through the planet, all right, they start filling in the gap. Obviously, when they go around, since the Earth is rotating, the gravitational force also attracts the satellite. So there are gaps of about 5 degrees. But every time the satellite passes, it will start filling in these gaps. All right. When the satellite goes through exactly the same orbit, then we call that the revisit time. All right. It revisited the site exactly at the same location. All right. And normally for Landsat is about 16 to 17 days. For Sentinel, it is much less because there are much more satellites going around. All right. Again, ESA has these Sentinels, as the Sentinel satellites. All right. Sentinel 1, and there's Sentinel 1A and 1B, so that the revisit time is less. That's how they reduce the revisit time. Basically, Sentinel 1A and 1B are exactly the same satellite. One is going up, one is going down, all right, in antiphase. And so they cover the globe in much quicker time. So Sentinel 1 are radars, all right? In fact, we're going to mention that. They are radars of this type. Sentinels 2 and 3 are optical satellites. So what's the difference? When it comes to radars, the satellite emits a wave, and expects the echo. Okay, so it's like a radar, like LIDAR. You emit something and wait for the echo. With optical, you don't emit anything. So you have the sun, which is illuminating the surface of the planet. It's transmitting electromagnetic waves. Some of these waves get absorbed by the surface. Some of them get re-emitted by the surface, because if you heat anything up, it will emit radiation after a while, all right? So we're measuring that radiation, and we measure the red intensity, the green intensity, the blue intensity, the infrared radiation, right? And the far infrared, mostly with optical. With radar, we have radio waves. The nice thing about radio is that they can penetrate through clouds. So with radars, we get data also if it's a little bit cloudy. With optical, if there's a cloud, if it's a cloud in the form of a heart or in the form of a plane, it still will block your rays, and you won't manage to get optical data if you have cloud. All right, but you don't transmit anything. So what kind of information we get? This is optical. So the bands here are the ones we measure, all right? The white parts are where the atmosphere absorbs everything. So it's useless measuring wavelengths here because the atmosphere absorbs the bands, all right? But where it is here, like the blue, the green, the red, the infrared, the far infrared, you get these bands, all right? And you can actually download these bands. I will show you how. Obviously, there are some bands that are within the part that the atmosphere absorbs in, and we measure that so that we can actually calculate how much the atmosphere is absorbing, all right? And whether it's a cloud pixel or a not cloud pixel. So it's also useful to measure a bit here. But basically, to download these, you can actually go to the Sentinel Data Hub. I will show you this in a bit. And you can actually download the raw products, all right? For Sentinel 2 and 3, you download these. For band 1 is the coastal aerosol, band 2 is the blue, band 3 is the green, band 4 is the red, band 5 is the vegetation red edge, band 6 is another red edge, band 7 is another red edge, band 8 is the near infrared. All right, so these are all the bands that you can use to calculate products, whether you want to calculate a vegetation index, whether you want to calculate a water quality index, right? All of these you can use. When it comes to radars, then it is we don't talk about bands, but we talk about polarization. All right. So electromagnetic bands are vertically or horizontally polarized. I'm not going to go into this detail. It's out of scope of this lesson. All right. But basically, when it comes to the ocean, we measure, we like to use a lot the vertical mode. So you transmit a vertical wave and you listen for the vertical echo, right? Not the horizontal. Why we need this? Why do we need, first of all, we need the passive ones, we need these kind of bands to have the blue, green, and red, and to visualize. All right, it's like taking a photo, red, green, blue. You can also calculate, consider the near infrared if you want to consider water quality or the amount of chlorophyll that you have in your waters. And when it comes to radars, we can use that to detect oil spills. All right, basically, like the very basic principle, if you don't have a spill, so you have roughness, rough water, and you get a wave coming that we're transmitting, it gets backscattered. All right, so some of the waves go back to our sensor. All right, so it appears bright. However, if you have a very smooth surface, all right, or unfortunately a surface on which there's oil, so it acts like a mirror, then the waves you're transmitting are reflected away from you. So no waves reach your sensor, and that will appear like a dark, a blackish part, all right, a black part, darker. And we need these two. For instance, you want to visualize oil spills, you need these two bands. As I promised, I can show you from where you can download data, right? So there is this ESA data hub, you call it. Obviously, once you get the notes, the slides, you have the URL. But if, again, if you type ESA data hub, you end up in this portal. All right, you just go to Open Hub. And as you can see now, and this is what I want to demonstrate, it is very similar to the interface of not rather than similar to the interface, the idea is exactly the same. Okay, so you define your area of interest by this box here. I want around Malta, right? And from here, you can actually see whether you want data mission data from Sentinel-1, data from Sentinel-2, or data from Sentinel-3, right? And for each one, you can actually give it the sensing period when when the satellite passed, all right? So let's say I want to measure to search all of October from there to there, and I want to see Sentinel-2 data set. So I just do that. I click search. You log in. Again, you can create one which is free, a free account. And now it will search all the data products that go in my selected region, right? And these are the products, right? And you can visualize them and you can download them. Now, when you download satellite products, again, you can open them in QGIS or ArcGIS. However, ESA produces this software called SNAP. And SNAP stands for the Sentinel Application Toolbox. All right, so this is a data that it was captured. This was captured on the 19th of October. All right, I can see that. So it's a multispectral imager from Sentinel-2A. And this was captured on the 23rd of October, 2023-10-19. All right, at 09:50 in the morning. All right, so very recent data. That's why we call it near real time. So your own data captured, you won't get data captured today. That is real time. But you get data captured near real time, so from yesterday, which is quite good. All right, so from here you can download optical data, Sentinel-2 and 3, or even radar data, Sentinel-1. All right. And I wanted to like give you a brief demonstration because oil spills do happen. All right. So well, you think but how come with all these radars and with all these navigational equipment? Accidents do happen. This was like a recent accident off the coast of Corsica 2 years ago. All right, so two ships collided. It was early on Sunday morning. The cause of accident is not known, but it's human error. All right, here are some graphic viewer discretion advised, because you're gonna see oil in the water soon. All right, so these are two ships that collided. Funnily enough, or not funnily, but how do you say it? Sarcastically, The area was declared as a marine protected area a couple of months before the accident, and then this happened, and a couple of tons of oil got leaked. And with retry, it was connected to another computer, sorry. Yes, this one. So with Snap, you can get the data from Copernicus, Sentinel-1, which is a radar, and Sentinel-2, which is a visual satellite, all right? So you get these kind of files, Sentinel-1 and Sentinel-2, all right? And quickly, I would like to show you, if we load them in Snap, which is just drag and drop, all right? I'm dropping a product for Sentinel-1A, so it's loading in Snap, and I'm loading Sentinel-2A, which is a visual satellite. Right, and here what I wanted to show you is that if we visualize, you're going to do this as a tutorial when we're meeting in Split, right, with Jesus. Yes, Jesus, what we call him, Jesus. So this is the visual satellite, all right? So visually, the area looked like this, creating an RGB from that satellite data. All right, so this is Corsica. And if we can zoom here, you can actually see the naughty ships. All right, those are the two naughty ships collided from satellite. But you cannot see the spill, right? You cannot really see the spill visually because it's black, the water is black, so you can't see it. And that's where radars come in, all right? So if we display the VV band that I showed you before, wait for it to load. All right, give it some more time. Yeah, there you go. All right, so this is the data from a radar now, Sentinel-1. And if we zoom in to the naughty ships, you can easily see, can you see it? Yes, the spill there. All right, so that's why you need a combination of radar and optical bands. All right, and then there's the whole EMSA service called CleanSynet that every day they analyze a lot of these images from different radars and from different optical satellites, and they provide a service, all right, the EMSA service, the CleanSynet service, where if there's a spill, they notify the country that are close to the spill, okay, so that they can mitigate it. But that is how we use satellite data and how you can access it free of charge, all right? Obviously, Snap also have tools. Snap is the software I told you, all right, by ESA, that it has inbuilt tools that you can give it, for instance, a Sentinel-2 image, and it computes chlorophyll for you, or the total suspended matter. And we did this, for instance, we had a massive storm in Malta on the 3rd of October, all right? So cars were carried away by the sea, etc. And you can also investigate how the suspended matter around our area with runoff changed around Malta. As you can see, the area around Malta was a lot of, or there was a lot of suspended matter, all right? So if you work with an environmental agency, this is really useful data because you can actually map the extent of runoff and of pollution, etc. For instance, if you have coastal construction, you can actually map up to which part this is affecting the surrounding coast, right? So that's also the last portal I wanted to mention is the MODNET one, all right? MODNET, what happened, Audrey? Her batteries died. So MODNET is another European-wide portal, all right? It has very good data sets. Whilst Copernicus is mostly targeted towards model data and satellite data, MODNET is mostly targeting in situ data, all right? There is some remote sensing data as well, such as that coming from HF radars. However, it's mostly targets static data sets rather than continuously updating. There is a very nice portal for MODNET. Before, MODNET had a different portal for the bathymetry, for chemistry, for physics. Now they integrated everything into one nice portal, which is this one, modnet.ec.europa.eu, the GeoViewer. And here you have a whole category, a catalog of parameters, all right? So you have the geology, you have the chemistry, you have the biology, you have the bathymetry. Here I like to visualize the bathymetry. You also have tools such as, for instance, you can calculate a profile. So look, all right, so this is the profile. I'll calculate the bathymetric profile between this point and this point. I think this is super cool. All right, and you can see here that there's a escarpment. So we go from very shallow waters here, the Malta shelf, to very, very deep waters, all right, minus 4,000. And here you can, for instance, actually see the bathymetry around Malta. If you zoom in, you can see that here is like a very, very shallow part that doesn't even go beyond 100 meters, right? And in fact, that's where from where we think that during the last ice age, animals from Sicily crossed to Malta, because we found some remains over here. All right, so you can actually see very I'm back, sorry. It's a very interesting lesson and my laptop cannot handle excitement very well. Mela, so yes, what I forgot to mention when we were discussing the satellite data and the optical and the radar to visualize the oil spills, okay? Sometimes the satellites, they are different satellites, they don't pass at exactly the same time. So while you might have the optical data for today, you might have the radar on a different day, all right? But if you find data sets that are close in time, then you can actually see the data. Was actually the files I showed you were separated by one day, all right? So yes, so I mentioned that as well. And now we're discussing MODNET, all right? So I was giving you, I'm showing you some bathymetry. Where is the MODNET thing? Can close this one. I can close the Copernicus ones. All right, yes. So this is the bathymetry. And there are also some nice ones here, mostly human activities, okay? In human activities, there's a very nice, apart from fisheries and environment and energy, etc., there's a nice set of tools that show you the route density, right? That shows the major ship routes, all right? And these are for the passenger vessels, for the fishing vessels, for the cargo vessels, all right? And these are given on a monthly basis, all right? So for instance, if you see the cargo vessels, you can actually see the route density of where cargo vessels pass. You can actually see that between Malta and Sicily, it's quite a hotspot. In fact, 80% of all cargo ships that go through it to the Mediterranean and pass between Malta and Sicily, right? So it's quite a hotspot. So there is a number of very interesting data layers that you can download. You can download them, and then you can import them in QGIS, all right? Again, just in case you don't believe me, I downloaded so MODNET bathymetry and MODNET human activities, all right? So these are the kind of files that you download directly from MODNET. And then if you're a QGIS fan or an ArcGIS fan, QGIS fan, I will load this. You can actually drag and drop this into QGIS and you see the bathymetry over there. All right, so the formats are in a way that you can easily import them in QGIS. So again, these are the nodes, how you can download bathymetry, how you can download the vessel density. And there's also information on physical parameters and chemical parameters. There's also some data sets on underwater noise, if you're interested in that. So yes, MODNET also has a nice section, apart from biology, chemistry, physical, blah, which is called MODNET data ingestion. And the whole idea behind this is that anyone that has sleeping data, so you collected like a couple of parameters and you saved everything on a pen drive, instead of keeping that in your drawer, you upload that on the MODNET data ingestion website, all right? So you don't have any sleeping data. There's also a nice video, if we can have a look at that, all right? That demonstrates this process. And you can do this while QGIS is loading. Wait, maybe before we show this, I can reshare my screen, but I will optimize it for sound as well. Oopsie.
Wake up your data.
Set them free at emodnetingestion.eu.
Here at eModNet, we share lots of data, 24/7 hard-working data. But there's some loose ends to be tied up in order to keep these networks strong and durable. We know there's still sleeping data out there. Good morning, government. Ahoy, Navy and offshore industry. Hello, NGOs. What's up, scientists and academics? There's a need for your old and recent data to strengthen Europe's marine open data network.
eModNet's data ingestion portal helps to wake up your data so it can serve blue growth. In the long run, this is good for everyone's figures. This data ingestion portal is a unique piece that funnels massive quantities of documented data packages, providing them with spick and span metadata. Using it is quick and easy, thanks to the straightforward submission workflow. In no time, you'll become the local data barista. First, grab your marine ID to identify yourself. Next, submit your data package along with its metadata and relevant documentation. Continue by filling out the submission form. This pre-filled form provides feedback on the go. And although it uses controlled vocabulary, you don't have to speak marine-ish fluently. One of the specialized data centers guides you through the submission process until everything is ready for upload. These data centers give feedback, verify your data packages, and tidy up their metadata. In addition to this quality check, they also provide safekeeping and further distribution of your data sets. That's right, every minute you invest pays off.
There's even a help desk at your service if things get fuzzy, or in case you had a rough night, okay, or your cat jumped out the window, or your friend flew in.
Well, whatever the cause, once your work is done, outstanding marine data infrastructures process your beefed up data sets and finally feed them into one of our thematic portals. eModNet offers bathymetry,
geology,
chemistry,
physics,
biology,
seabed habitats,
human activities, and coastal mapping.
No need to browse all that. Just use the Discovery and Access service as a bypass to your submitted data packages or to find more data sets and data products.
The Data Wanted service over here delivers data on demand. Tell us what you need, and if we don't have it, we'll try to find it and wake it up.
Thanks to this roaring ingestion factory, eModNet can streamline massive data submission and finally turn data into value, while you get the credit and peer visibility. More than ever before, European marine data will work together.
Embrace the opportunity to contribute to Blue Society. Set your data free for others to work with, and you'll get a strong net in return. Wake them up
at emodnetingestion.eu.
Right, so that was about emodnet. And now, if code is loaded, I can show you how easy it is. You just take the file you download from emodnet, you drag it into MQGIS, and you'll get, hopefully, yes, unless my computer crashes again, a nice view of the bathymetry, right, the one I downloaded. And as an example, it's loading, right, there you go, right, so there's the bathymetry. You can also then import like shapefiles for your country, and then you have bathymetry around your area, right? And I know some of you are experts more than I am on QGIS, so you can also download, change the symbology, and say I want to display up to 250 meters, and there you have. Wait, it's loading. Give it some time. There you go. All right, so your nice bathymetry around your area. Yes, so that's about it. The last portal that I wanted to mention is this is again some data on QGIS about the root density and vessel density. The last portal I wanted to mention is the World Ocean Database. All right, so when you have data coming from, for instance, CTDs and ocean stations, you can actually find this here. All right, there's a portal for it as well. You can just go to this, because the zoom thing is in the middle, I can see it. Yes, You can download World Ocean Database, and you can again search for the type of data that you want. You launch the World Ocean Database select, and you specify the criteria, whether you want to search by geographic coordinates, whether by the dates, by the data set, and then you build the query and download the data, right? The things that you download from here, the files, are easily read by a software called Ocean Data View. All right, again, it's a free of charge software. You can download it. It was part of this DataNet project. It's really good because it can allow you to quality control your data much easily, etc. Very, very easily, etc. But that you'll get a very good demonstration of this software in Split during one of the training sessions. Okay, so we have a whole session about that. So I guess that's what I wanted to show you, some portraits from where you get data. I don't know if there are any questions before we move to the sad part, sad as part of the session, which is the quiz. Did you upload the questions or did... not yet? All right.
There are any questions?
Let's see if there are any questions, because the chat was quiet, but at least we remained at 45 participants, so we'll not lose anyone along the way.